Hey, street talking other stuff, Mike Maddog Magnotti. Thanks for being with us today. Hey, we got a good show for you today. But as always, I appreciate you tuning in on this Monday morning or whatever time during the week that you're watching this. Makes me feel good to know that at least five or six of you are out there catching my show. So, hey, but again, nice to be here. Appreciate it. I love being with you. I hope you enjoy it too. But you know, that's an interesting thing. This kid once said to his father, Dad, what's the difference between confident and confidential? And the father thought for a minute and said, well, Timmy, you're my son. Of that, I'm confident. But your friend Jimmy, he's also my son, but that's confidential. Okay, and you know, I do mental health counseling and marital counseling. And I had a couple in my office the other day, and the husband said, we just had this huge fight over discussing a living will. And I said, well, living will is probably a good thing for you guys to be talking about. Husband said, yeah, I thought so too. And I said, we should discuss it. And I told my wife, I said, I just want you to know, I never want to live in a vegetative state dependent on some fluid in bottles. If I'm ever like that, just pull the plug. I said, well, what's wrong with that? Well, he looked over at his wife, who had her arms folded and was frowning at him. She said, well, she got up, unplugged the TV and poured out all the beer. Okay. All right. But hey, appreciate you being here today. I got a good show. I've got a very interesting guest, a combat veteran from Afghanistan. We're going to talk about that in a little bit, but just kind of give you a little bit of taste of what we're going to be talking about. America's longest war. Joe Biden, President Biden said he's going to pull us out about 4 months from now on September 11th. But I wanted to talk with somebody who's actually been there. So my guest today, Chris Mann, he's going to be with us in a few minutes. But hey, street talking other stuff, Mike Mad Dog Magnotti. You stick around. We will be right back.
Make being home fun again. Blue Lagoon Pool and Spa has just what you need to bring fun back into your backyard. We have a wide selection of artesian spas and swim spas, new and used to choose from. We are happy to announce we are now selling Rainbow Kids play structures with 50 models to choose from. To help finish off your entertainment area, we have patio furniture and Komodo Joe grills. At Blue Lagoon Pool and Spa, we have just what you need to bring family fun and entertainment to your backyard. Stop by today.
Are you ready to freshen up your home? Boswell's expansive two-story showroom is filled with high-quality furniture that's always discounted to give you their best price every day. Boswell's is receiving new furniture deliveries each week, so you'll be sure to find just what you need for your home without the wait. Complimentary design assistance and free local delivery. Superior customer service and the best value for your money. Start at Boswell's on Easy Street. It's closer than you think.
Okay, we're back. Street talking other stuff. Mike, Mad Dog Magnotti, and we're talking with my friend Chris Mann. Chris, how are you today, pal?
I'm good, Mad Dog. How are you, bud?
Hey, I'm really good, and I'm glad, just proud to have you on. Now, here's the thing. Chris is I'm going to say a former Marine, because I know Marines stay Marines their whole life. He's had two deployments to the Middle East, one to Iraq, another to Afghanistan. And I wanted to talk, though, we'll talk about both of the things. I did want to talk today with him and ask him to come on to talk about the Afghanistan situation. This has been America's longest war, 20 years, okay? And looking at some statistics, over 2,300 of our young people were killed in this war, and over 20,000 have been injured. Many more civilians and military personnel on the other side have suffered as well. So it's just, I know we have a lot of opinions about this thing, but I wanted to have Chris on today because Chris, having been there, can give us a little more of an insight into what it looked like with the boots on the ground type of thing. So Chris, first and foremost, thanks for your service. You've done stuff that many of us couldn't do, wouldn't do, and just wouldn't do in the fact that we can't. But proud to know you, proud to have been your friend for a good part of your life. And again, thanks for coming on today. So
yeah, absolutely. I appreciate it.
Okay, so a little bit about yourself, just some background, family, that kind of thing, connection with the community.
Yeah, grew up in Wenatchee since I was 2 or 3 years old, went to high school here, families here, extended families all here, so Wenatchee's home. After my senior year, I joined the Marines and spent 8 years active duty.
Okay, what was the idea of the choice of the Marine Corps?
So it originally started, I was actually going to be, I was trying to join the Coast Guard to do their rescue swimming program, but there was a year delay getting to their boot camp even. And so it was one of those, I knew myself and I knew I couldn't sit around Wenatchee for a year. And I had a couple of buddies who were joining the Marines and they were kind of like, well, come check it out. And got in there and the recruiter's like, you wouldn't make it.
Really?
He totally Jedi mind tricked me. And it was like, oh, okay, I got this. So.
Oh, you're kidding me.
He was just. Oh yeah. He knew exactly what to say to get me to go, I got this. I can do this.
Yeah. So that's interesting. You know, I think then, you know, my son Tony was in there too. You joined after Tony did, right?
A couple years after Tony.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I asked Tony too why I did it because, you know, Tony, as a lot of people do, joined to help with their educational expenses. But the Marines offer nothing other than the GI Bill, right?
Correct. I had the option to have, while I was active duty, to take classes at night and stuff.
Right.
But I never took advantage of it.
Okay. But what was it? It must have been a little bit more, but just you couldn't get into the Coast Guard that made you join the Corps.
Nope, that was literally it. It was, I cannot stay in Wenatchee.
Yeah.
I met with all the recruiters and the Army was like, oh yeah, you know, we'll give you a big old bonus, which, you know, 18 years old, you're like, cash money, great. Oh. The Navy recruiter just annoyed me and I was like, he was out right away. But it was, I don't know, it was just the Marine recruiter was just so sure of himself.
Yeah.
And the minute he started challenging me, it was kind of that, oh, I can do this.
Yeah. And you went to boot camp down in San Diego, right?
San Diego, yep.
How was that? How'd you do? So,
I mean, it's boot camp, so it's, yeah, you know, just a really nice 3-month summer camp. Yeah. Right next to an airport where you watch planes coming and going every day for 3 months. So, but no, it's boot camp. It was exactly what I expected it to be, and I don't regret it.
And then you, of course, had the crucible at the end of boot camp, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, so when I went in, they were actually, because the way they had it set up, we actually did our crucible the end of the second month.
Okay.
Because then they wanted to transport us the second month.
Oh, second month. Okay.
Yeah. Because they used to go, 1 month in San Diego, 1 month in Camp Pendleton, up north, up the coast, about an hour and a half, where all the field training and stuff was. And then you'd go back down to MCRD San Diego for the third month.
Right.
And so in order for them to not have to transport us back and forth, we just did the crucible at the end of the second month.
Okay. Now, for those who aren't familiar with it, why don't you just give a brief description of what the crucible was?
Yeah, so the crucible... So obviously you do your whole month of your range quals and, you know, obstacle courses, different team building exercises. And the culmination of it is a 54-hour team building exercise. So you're broken down into about a platoon size and you go and you do all these different courses, small courses. And throughout the time you're learning about Medal of Honor recipients. So each event and obstacle has a story. So you're kind of learning the knowledge and history of the Marine Corps. And then you do the event.
Right.
And that's 54 hours, 3 meals, and it's pretty continuous. So if you can crash and grab a half hour between events, if it's a little backed up, but it's a great team building. And then the end of the last day is the Reaper. So in San Diego, for all the West Coast Marines, it is a pretty, pretty vertical hike. Sorry, my dog. It's a pretty vertical hike that is just layer after layer, pretty much going up a fire cut.
Right.
And that at the top of that mountain is typically where we received our Eagle, Lobe, and Anchors there.
Right.
And then after that, you hike back down. And this is all after you've had three meals in 54 hours and
very little sleep, right?
Yeah, the sleep, the exhaustion, and then you get down and then they have like a warrior's breakfast, but you're just so exhausted at that point. It's just like, just let me.
Yeah, but pretty proud of yourself at the same time, right?
Yeah, oh, definitely. I mean, because that's like the final thing. And nowadays, they've realized that that needs to be the last thing in boot camp. And so they ship them back up for the last 4 days.
Right.
That is the final thing that they do at boot camp now.
Yeah. Well, that's the way it was with Tony when he was there. And I thought it was that's the way it always was.
Yeah. It's unless we were just on a weird cycle.
Yeah. All right. Well, there's some, before we get into your deployments, there's something else I want to ask you. The Marines pride themselves on being riflemen. Okay. Now you had weapons and rifle experience before you went into the Marine Corps, right?
Yeah.
Okay. How did that work? Because I know they would rather have somebody who's never touched a gun before, a rifle, so they can teach it properly. How did you do with, the way the Marines taught you as opposed to what you knew before?
It was a struggle to forget what my dad had taught me and adjust to what they want to see. And it didn't matter if it felt comfortable for me, do it their way,
right.
You know, get through the rifle quals. And then from there on out, after every time I went to the range, it was just whatever's comfortable for me. I know how to shoot.
Yeah. Okay. So how did you do? What'd you shoot?
So when I graduated boot camp, I shot sharpshooter because I missed the make or break point. And then every other year after that, I shot expert.
Okay. And sharpshooter's above expert, correct?
No, it's one below it. So it's right. Yeah. I got the equivalent of second place by 1 point.
Yeah. All right. Well, good for you. Okay. Do you still use those techniques when you go hunting now? Because I know you're an avid hunter. So, or do you go back to what your dad taught you?
For the most part. And I don't really rifle hunt much anymore. I have a bow and I love bow hunting.
Oh, okay. All right. Okay. So, what happened? Tell us about your Marine Corps experience and tell us about specifically, let's focus on Afghanistan today, if you would.
Okay. Yeah, so I was attached to 1st Battalion, 3rd Marines out of Detroit. And I was attached to 1st Battalion, 3rd Marines out of Hawaii. Yeah. And it's like he knows I'm on the.
What is that, your dog?
It's my dog just losing his mind in the background. he's got a tennis ball in his mouth, and because usually I'm sitting in class, and I just throw the ball, and he, you know, so he sees my laptop on my lap, and he assumes that it's playtime. So we were attached in Hawaii, and we did our first deployment in Afghanistan in 2005, 2006.
Okay.
We were over in, I was in a town called Jalalabad. And just a crazy experience. Not so much just for what was over there. It was just culture shock for myself from, small town Wenatchee to, a high desert. I don't really know how to describe this pretty desolate part of the country. It was just, and it was strange because I was given a book before I went over there called The Kite Runner.
Right.
And so I was reading that book while I was over in this country. And, the author talking about how this is this flourishing town that we were supposed to be in. And I'm looking at this just desolate wasteland.
Right.
So it was really interesting as far as that goes, but the people, the local fare and the cuisine, I really enjoyed that because I like food. But just meeting them, I mean, there was a lot of good people caught in between a really bad situation.
Right. Okay, now had you been given much indoctrination about Afghanistan? Did you know anything about the country before you went? How did the Marines prepare you for, what you, the culture shock, like you say?
So the only thing that I knew about Afghanistan was from my battalion commander. 2 days before we actually like got on the planes, he showed us a video of 9/11 and said, remember why we're going there.
Really?
And that was pretty much my experience with Afghanistan.
Okay, but they didn't talk to you about culture and dealing with the indigenous people. Didn't say anything about being careful how you treat the women or anything like that. That's interesting.
I mean, we were told do not speak to the women. Like, just okay. Don't even acknowledge them. They're not anything. But I was also I was a junior Marine, so I was not privy to if, you know, the platoon sergeants were getting better training. I wasn't privy to that. I was there to just follow orders.
Okay. And what was your job on your first deployment there when you first got?
So that deployment, I went over and did logistics.
Okay.
But it ended up when I got there, I was supposed to be doing field drops of supplies for missions. But then when we got there, it was like, oh, we don't need this. So you're going to do convoys and, you know, security. And that was, so I did convoy security. And then I escorted detainees. When we pick them up from the field, I would fly in on a helicopter, right, hop out, pick them, receive them from the unit that had captured them, receive all their gear, get them back on the helicopter, and then take them to be interrogated.
Well, that and the convoy duty must have gotten pretty interesting. So,
you know, and it's really strange because I was so young. I mean, I was 18,
right,
19 when I was over there. So it was, looking back and thinking now, it's like, man, I was dumb. Like, there's so much that I didn't document, pictures,
sure,
experiences of just, I mean, because once you got out of like the Jalalabad city, the mountains, I mean, it's a beautiful country. Like, it reminds me a lot of OMAC, Okanagan Valley, kind of that, the Medhow area, a lot like that, just really nice country.
Okay, well, look, we got to take a break, Chris. But again, I'm talking with Chris Mann. He is a former Marine who's been deployed twice overseas, once to Afghanistan, which primarily what we're talking about today, and another time to Iraq. But we're going to take a quick break. But I got some specific stuff I want to talk with Chris about when we're coming back, seeing as how this America's longest war, 20 years, is coming to an end in almost four months from today, or around now, on September 11th is when President Biden says we're going to be leaving that country. But hey, street talking, other stuff. You stick around. We will be right back.
Getting ready for the boating season is easy with the help of Bombfile Boats and Motors. With marine technology changing fast, the service department stays up to date with the newest developments and factory certifications. They have what it takes to make boating fun and hassle-free for the summer. Then as that garage and driveway fill up in the fall, one call is all it takes to learn about their convenient service and storage packages. Now's the time to call and find out why Washington boaters have been trusting Bombfile Boats and Motors to service, store, and maintain their boats for over 70 years.
When you call Dix Heating and Air Conditioning, you're calling on 35 plus years of experience in the Wenatchee Valley. Spending extra time in your home, you may have discovered an unwanted aroma. Stinky feet, pets, who knows what. Call Dix today about installing their Trane Clean Effects electronic air cleaner or a Rheem Halo ultraviolet air purifier. Either way, the air quality in your home will be improved. Proudly servicing all of North Central Washington, call 884-6444 today.
Okay, we're back talking with Mr. Chris Mann, two-time deployment to the Middle East, once to Afghanistan, which we're talking about today, and another time in Iraq when he was with the Marine Corps. He's a local Wenatchee boy, and I wanted to have him on today to ask him some specific stuff about this war that we're finally pulling out of. All right, Chris, what was the reception of the people to the Americans there? I mean, how did the people get along? What did they think about us? What was your observation?
So a lot of what I've noticed, and obviously this has been 15 years since I was over there. My experience was obviously if they were like third party nationals or working with the coalition forces,
right,
they tended to have a pretty good attitude. But you kind of always tell that it was just about the money. They were kind of indifferent. Yes, they supported us, you know, liberating them from the Taliban. But then there was also towns where you would be rolling through on a convoy and you would just kind of see the glares.
Right.
And it was kind of this, and, you know, obviously this is a country that has pretty much just been at war for hundreds of years. I mean, the Russians, the Taliban, they're just, they are a country of warriors. And so it's kind of that local look like, oh, you know, the next great conquerors here.
Right.
But when we would meet with village elders and stuff, obviously they were being paid off pretty, they were being paid well. So they were obviously very hospitable to us.
Right.
But I never got, like, obviously until there was, obviously when you get in a firefight, that goes a little different. But, it, you know, speaking with the locals was never, they were never really rude to me. I didn't really, obviously I was very low on the totem pole, so I didn't get a ton of interactions. But for the most part, it was, they were friendly and, you know, would just, some were just curious too, because how, you know, how we would dress or just carry ourselves. So they would, it was just, they had questions. I got a lot of questions about American sports.
Right, right. They ask about our politics, that type of thing?
Not to me. Again, I wasn't important enough for any of that.
Okay. Well, did you, I mean, you mentioned it a little bit, but did you have much contact with the locals? I mean, eat with them, spend any time recreating or talking to them, that type of stuff?
Maybe three times throughout my 6 months over there. It was, again, I was the low man, you know, I didn't get invited or wasn't privy to any of these dinners. Occasionally me and a couple buddies would have one of our terps. He would go out in town and buy local food for us and bring it back onto the base for us.
Right.
And just so we could try it, we'd, you know, foot bread and kebab and just, you know, stuff. I wanted to experience some of that.
Sure.
But and so like, that was
like the food, huh?
I did. I love Middle Eastern cuisine.
Okay, what about alcohol? Because most of them being Muslims probably, you know, I mean, and I know Marines like to drink beer. I don't mean to be, you know, stereotypical, but, I mean, you know.
So, yeah, Afghanistan under the Taliban regime is a dry country.
Sure.
Obviously, there were still locals who, you know, in towns, you know, Kabul, sure, is a big city where they're, you would be able to get alcohol there. Where we were at, nothing.
Yeah.
We were lucky to have a bazaar once a month on our base and where they would come and bring bootleg DVDs to sell us.
Okay.
So as far as alcohol, I didn't ever experience it. A lot of tea. That was about the most I drank, tea and water.
And now you just, you know, at the grunt level, like you're speaking of, what you guys think about, how did you feel about being there? What was the thought behind it?
You know, so my perspective has changed, obviously, as I've grown up.
Right.
When I was there, all I wanted was to get in firefights. And I didn't care with who. As I've obviously grown and evolved, I realized that there's, you know, there, like I said, the conversations that I never got to ask people about just how they felt about us being there. They weren't any issues to my, you know, to me at that time.
Right. Well, was that wish ever fulfilled? Ask you briefly.
No, not really. I mean, at least not in that country. In Iraq, I was able to talk more with locals.
Right.
I was a little bit higher up in the food chain. And so I would, you know, get to actually have interactions.
Right. Okay, so this this decision that, you know, I mean, we were down to, I think, 9,000 people for a while, what's his name? Trump was president, but then that went up again. I don't know the exact numbers, but now President Biden says we're pulling out by September 11th. Your thoughts on that? I mean, both what you would have thought then and how you look back on it now with some reflection and some...
You know... as much as I don't want us there,
right,
I feel like NATO's not going to do it, and the Afghan government is not strong enough. They're so tight with their tribe or their, you know, their tribal alliances and their tribal that their government will not withstand it. So I really do feel, unfortunately, there's going to be a power vacuum.
Right.
And it, that country's going to be primed for the pickings again.
Yeah.
I do think, and I've been in contact with a few, I guess like private contractor companies that are ramping up. They're hiring like crazy.
Yeah.
Because they're going to be the ones trying to stabilize the country. When we pull out, we're going to pull everything out. It's just going to, it's that vacuum effect. You know, do I support us getting out of that country, but I think announcing, hey, we're pulling everybody out. That's not, I mean, there needs to be a transition. You know, it needs to be not necessarily drug out for years, but there needs to be plans where, okay, we're going to pull out this unit and let the Afghan soldiers take over this part and really just ensure that that country's not going to become a failed state again.
Right, right. Do you think, you know, from what you saw the Afghani army there, do you think they're going to be able to handle things?
You know, like I said, when we were there, I mean, obviously it was 15 years ago.
Right.
No, I wouldn't have trusted them then. They're 90% of them were corrupt and or not even traditionally trained. They were just kind of almost like a volunteer militia. And that could have changed, obviously, in the years. We've had training teams over there constantly, training units. So I hope that they can withstand it, but I don't know. I haven't looked into that country enough lately to know where they stand on anything.
Yeah. Do you have any contact with, you know, other Marines you were there with, or even any people in country back there? Any continued contact with them?
You know, everybody that I was over there with has either retired or gotten out.
Yeah.
I don't know many that have gone back over since. Like I said, obviously with it kind of hinted to me when the private contractors are starting to ramp up again that they're understanding that it's that vacuum's going to happen.
Yeah.
We pull out and somebody's going to have to be there.
Well, it's not the first time, like you said. Yeah. Afghanistan, I mean, there's been people in and out, you know. It's just,
yeah.
Well, interesting. Okay. Well, hey, appreciate you being on. We're going to take another quick break and come back, say goodbye. But hey, we're talking with Mr. Chris Mann. He was actively deployed to Afghanistan as a Marine Corps, as a Marine 15 years ago. I just wanted to have him on to have some insights from a person from his perspective. But street talking other stuff. We're going to come back, say goodbye to Chris in a minute, but stick around. We will be right back.
Mary Maids of Wenatchee has been professionally cleaning and sanitizing homes and businesses in North Central Washington since 1998. Mary Maids uses commercial-grade cleaners and viricides. Mary Maids has implemented additional safety and sanitation protocols. They are strictly following CDC guidelines for the safety of their clients and employees. For expert help with cleaning and sanitizing your home or business, call or look up Mary Maids of Wenatchee to schedule your free estimate today.
Okay, we're back. Chris, look, just thanks for your service. We appreciate it. You know, people who serve this country, sometimes, you know, reasons are confusing. Sometimes it's not as clear as we wish it would be. But I know that you went into it with the right attitude, gave it your all. And, you know, we just appreciate what folks like you have done for us. And I, on behalf of many, many people, just want to say thanks for your service, buddy.
I appreciate it, Mike. Thank you.
You know, I'll tell you, whenever I'm in Safeway or someplace else and I see somebody wearing a veteran's hat, you know, from whatever area where they served, I always make it a point to tell them thanks. So, and I hope other people do too. So, okay. So Chris, hey, wish you the best. Stay in touch. Say hi to your mom and dad for me. And hey, street talking other stuff. Mike Maddog Magnotti. Thanks for tuning in today. We will see you next time. Bye-bye.